It's kind of an anticlimax now, isn't it? After that, well, I hope not too much, because we're going to read the Bible from John chapter 20. I think that's page 906 in the Church Bible. John chapter 20, first 10 verses of this chapter. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going toward the tomb. Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying there, and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes. Now I want you to imagine that this is Easter Day. Well, it is Easter Day. I was just seeing if you're awake. But imagine this is the first Easter day, and round about this time of day. What do we know? Round about this time of day, on that first Easter day. Well, news reports are coming in. We've bumped into Nathaniel, perhaps. Or we've bumped into Philip. And we've been hearing reports that the tomb is empty. That's all we know. By this stage, on Easter Day, that's all we know. Because the focus of this chapter, or these verses that we've just read, brings us face to face with the first glimmer of something being wrong on that first Easter day. The passage doesn't take it any further than that. We're just going to stick to what the passage says. We may look elsewhere, but we're going to try and put ourselves into the position of the disciples at this point, at this time, on the first Easter day. It's not till later that the disciples who are mentioned here will actually meet the risen Lord. It's not till later that Mary Magdalene herself will have an encounter with the risen Christ. But as the day unfolds beyond this time, bits of information will come to us, but it won't be until tonight at our evening service that the Lord Jesus will appear himself in person. We don't know that yet. Later in the afternoon, we'll hear that Mary Magdalene says that she's seen him. But we dismiss that. We'll come back to that later on. All we're going on at the moment is that at this time of day, the tomb is empty. We do not yet know that the great victory has been won, that the Lord of life has conquered. His presence has not yet been manifested in his risen glory. We cannot sing any of the hymns we've just sung today, yet. So let's look at the passage and see how there's a movement in the passage. The first movement is this, the discovery of the empty tomb. We read these words, "On the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark." Now that there was a tomb is quite an amazing eventuality, because usually, normally, crucified victims would be interred in a mass grave where remains would be undiscernible. among the other bodies thrown in there, it would be difficult to identify whose body was whose. And that would have been Jesus' fate had not a ranking member of the Jewish aristocracy arranged for his body to be taken down from the cross and taken to a new tomb, a tomb presumably that would hold the bodies of Joseph of Arimathea himself, who owned the tomb, and members of his family, but which was empty. That's a very important, crucial piece of information. It was a new tomb, and it was empty of any other bodies in it. And we're introduced in the first verse to one of the women that we had described who were around the cross. These women were there at the cross to see the taking, well, to see the agony of Jesus, to see the death of Jesus, to see him being taken down from the cross, to see his body being wrapped up at the bottom of the cross. They had gone with those who'd done that, those men who'd carried the body to the tomb. They'd gone with them. They saw where the tomb was. They saw it sealed with a great stone. In fact, they even use that language when they're describing it. A very large stone, they say. And they'd seen it sealed with the imperial seal of Rome as a bodyguard, were camped out in front of it to ensure that the disciples don't come to steal the body. Mary, along with these women, had been there as Jesus died. And they had not had the opportunity, because Sabbath was coming on that Friday and the evening was coming, as darkness approached, they had to be back home to observe the Sabbath. We know who some of these women were. We know Mary Magdalene was one. Mary, the mother of Joseph, was another. Mary, the mother of James. Salome, Joanna, and other women are all mentioned by name in other of the Gospels. These women who witnessed his burial and his tomb are the same women who will find the same tomb empty on that first Easter morning. And right here, we have one of the first hints at the historicity of the account that we are reading. I remind you that in the first century in Judaism, women were disqualified from giving testimony in a court of law. If you were serious about a matter, you would never call on a woman to give testimony to it. That was the culture of the day. And yet central to the credibility of the gospel story, do you see? Central to the credibility of the gospel story is that it was these women who will now enjoy full membership of the Church of Jesus Christ, who are intentionally positioned as credible witnesses. These women who were witnesses to the tomb being full on Good Friday, Jesus' body interred there, are the same women who are witnesses to the tomb being empty on Easter Day. The same people. Now, what we do know from the other Gospels is that a number of these women rose very early while it was still dark and made their way out of the city in the dark. And as they made their way out of the city, going towards the garden tomb where it was, the first chinks of day began on the horizon. They came with their spices to anoint the body of Jesus. That was just their way of doing the normal preparations that were normally done for a normal funeral in those days, and it was a way of expressing their love and devotion towards Jesus. And Mark even reports, and here's a reality check, their discussions as they made their way from the city. They got up early, they'd met up, they were going down towards the tomb, and as they're going, somebody pipes up, "How are we going to move the stone? We hadn't thought about that one." And Mark records that that conversation was taking place. And that's where somebody mentions that it's a very large stone. Mary Magdalene, who may have been the youngest one of the group, somehow separates from them. Probably she walked faster. We have people in our family who don't walk as fast as others, so she probably was a fast walker, and she pressed on ahead, and she got to the grave first. She was soon followed by the others, by the way, and you can catch that fact by the report that she gives to the disciples when she says, "We don't know where they laid him." In other words, the other women joined her, but she was first there. And Mary, we're told in verse 1, was the first person that saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. Now, who is this Mary Magdalene? In all four Gospels, Mary is celebrated for being the one person who was there when Jesus needed her. Mary was there as he hung upon the cross. Mary was with Jesus as he suffered on the cross, as he died on the cross. She was there when he was buried. And now she's there post-burial to do what she can for Jesus. It's as if this woman would never leave him, even when he had to leave her. And there's a sense as we read the story in each of the Gospels, on that first Easter Sunday, the only evidence of Christianity that is visible and publicly noticeable are these women. The apostles have disappeared off the scene. They are nowhere to be found. And the great emphasis in the report of these women is what they saw. That word to see is emphasized. What they saw was that the stone was rolled away. In Matthew's account, the verb to see is used repeatedly. So the women leave the city to go to see the tomb, the grave. Six times, whether by angels or by one another, they're told to look, to see. When one of the angels commands them, when they eventually go into the tomb, the angel tells them to come and see where the body was as a visual aid. When he says, "The body is not here because he's risen." Twice they go and tell the disciples that Jesus has told them that later on they will see Jesus themselves. In other words, this emphasis on the women seeing protects the resurrection account from being misrepresented as people having dreams or psychological visions or ecstatic hallucinations. The emphasis is that these women saw with their eyes the way you see with your eyes today. Another indicator of the historicity of the event is Mary's reaction to the empty tomb. You see, an empty tomb really doesn't tell you very much. An empty tomb does not tell you about resurrection per se. There are other explanations that you can have for an empty tomb. And Mary went for one of those explanations rather than resurrection. And by the way, she wasn't the only one. The disciples all did that. They never thought of resurrection. So she has a look in the tomb and immediately feels she must report to the apostles. So off she goes and she comes to them with the news. The tomb is empty. They've taken the Lord out of the tomb and we do not know where they have laid him. That initial report, it's all that we know by this time. The tomb is empty. Maybe it's been robbed. Maybe the authorities have taken the body away so that nobody can do anything with the body and make it a center for religious observance. Mary has seen that body interred. She's seen the stone put in its place. She's seen the guards stationed there. and now everything was gone. And another one of the other Gospels, she suggests to the disciples, an enemy has done this. Now, what is clear from that story is that Mary herself was not expecting resurrection. This was not wishful thinking. Resurrection didn't cross her mind. And from our standpoint, as we look at the story, of course, we now know that without an empty tomb, there would have been no resurrection. Because it's the resurrection of the body. Nobody in Judaism would have believed if they'd gone around saying there'd been a resurrection and that there was still a body lying around somewhere. That wouldn't have happened. Could Jesus be risen if his body remained in the tomb? No. But at this point, nobody's thinking like that. Well, secondly, there's the investigation of the tomb. And by this point, this investigation has taken place. The discovery was by Mary. The investigation was carried out by Peter and John, the two leading disciples. And so we read in verses 4, 3 and 4 these words. Peter went out with the other disciple, that is the one Jesus loved. That was John's favorite expression for himself, not his love for Jesus, but the love that Jesus had for him. It was overwhelming to him that Jesus should love him. And they were going toward the tomb. Both of them were running together. But the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. So John got there. He leans in and looks in. And as he looked in, stooping to look in, it says, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. The linen cloths lying there. But what he saw got his attention. Why? He saw the linen cloths that had bound the body of Jesus, and they're lying there undisturbed. And perhaps John is wondering now whether Mary's surmise was wrong. But he didn't know the answer. If somebody had stolen the body, why would the grave clothes be there undisturbed? If the body had been seized, if it was robbers, it would take valuable time up to take the clothes off. But anyway, why would anybody do that, whether they're friend or foe? Well, John doesn't have very long to think because Peter's already caught up now. And Peter, true to character, doesn't come up and stop. At the entrance at full speed, impulsive as ever, he propels himself immediately through the door into the tomb. That's the force of the language. And once Peter is in there, he sees what John saw, but he saw something else. He saw the linen cloths lying there, but he also, verse 7, saw the face cloth which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with linen cloths, but folded up in a place by itself. Now, when I was young, about 17 maybe, 16, 17, college in the summer, I worked in a hospital, in an orthopedic ward every summer, and in that ward, basically as an orderly, you just did what the nurses told you to do, which was quite a lot. One of the things that I got involved in doing was dressing a dead body. And there were things you had to do, and I won't describe them for you because it would embarrass you. But one of the things we had to do is to put a cloth around the head, keep the jaw in place. That's what this cloth was. The grave clothes in this case were in exactly the same position that they'd been in when they enfolded and enclosed the body of Jesus. That's what got their attention. They were unaltered, untouched, undisturbed. Those clothes were intended to keep the hands and feet of the body together and to serve as a kind of basis to keep the head in one place. And now they lay there, left behind in good order, each in its own place, except for the headband, which Peter noticed had been wrapped up and put to one side. There they are, silent witnesses to something that has happened. In Matthew's account, it was an angel that rolled away the stone, not to let Jesus out, but to let the women in, the disciples later in. And the angel summoned them. He is not here. He is risen. So from the very beginning, we're thinking, from our perspective, this is a bodily resurrection. This is a bodily resurrection, but they were not thinking that yet. Well, the third thing we notice about the story is the significance of the empty tomb. Three different Greek words are used for seeing, and they're used in this passage. In verse 5, John looked into the tomb, and he saw in just an ordinary way, like you and I see with our eyes, seeing is believing. In verse 6, we're told that Peter saw, but this time he saw the linen clothes lying there, and literally he took notice of what he saw. This got his attention, and he noted it mentally. And then in verse 8, John, especially when he saw that linen headband wrapped up by itself, he saw and believed. And the word that's used there means to see with an inward perception and understanding. John saw and understood. You know, these disciples have allowed this to be in your Bible. By this point in the day, Peter and John and the other disciples are not even thinking about resurrection. Mary Magdalene would go on to meet Jesus, but when she tells the apostles later today, it says they would not believe it. When the other women, they have an encounter and they meet the angel and the angel tells them about Jesus being alive and they go to the apostles to tell them, we're told that the apostles did not believe them because it seemed to them to be an idle tale. Actually, if you have a Spanish version of the Bible, it's very colorful language. They just thought it was an absolute joke, basically. They didn't believe the women. Later on, when Jesus met two disciples on the road to Emmaus and they went back and told the rest, it says they did not believe them. By this time, on that first Easter day, the disciples do not believe in the resurrection of the dead. Mark and Luke report the disciples' embarrassing lack of faith and their disparaging dismissal of the women's claims as an idle woman's tale. Now, interestingly, isn't it? It's the men who've written these gospels. They're telling their own story. And they're putting all of this in because they want you to know that that's what happened. Chastened now, they recognize that God chose the women to be the first eyewitnesses of the risen Lord. Perhaps even to show up their sinful prejudice and teach them a lesson. But also to show them that the women were their secret weapon. Far from being an embarrassment, the fact that these women were the first to see the empty tomb, the first to meet the risen Lord, would end up being one of the strongest arguments for the credibility of the resurrection. One scholar puts it like this. First, the apostles' lack of faith demonstrates that they're not gullible, they're not easily fooled, they won't believe anything. Secondly, that the women come as the first to see and proclaim the risen Jesus. That is so counter-cultural. You put those two facts together. The apostles are not gullible, and the women got there first. They're the ones who confirm the resurrection before the apostles do. This story is not contrived. Jewish men would never dream up a story like this. In fact, they're honest enough to tell you that tonight, on that first Easter day, when they're all together and Jesus does come, the first thing Jesus says to them is this. He upbraided them for their unbelief and hardness of heart because they would not believe those who saw him after he had risen. First thing they remember Jesus saying to them when they saw him alive was he gave them into trouble for not taking the women seriously. That's an evidence of the credibility of the gospel. But though Peter went away wondering, John went away understanding and believing. He grasped that something else must have happened to the body. What we later learn is that the Lord's natural body, this is how resurrection works. We're told about this in 1 Corinthians 15. The natural body of flesh and blood had been changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, into a spiritual body that immediately could be somewhere else. That remained his body, but could immediately, by some action of God, which, by the way, will happen to your body on the day of resurrection, by the action of God, was changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, and was immediately able to move to heaven as well as to move around on earth, able to appear anywhere, whether in heaven or on earth, at any point, by his own will. So this stupid idea that sometimes parroted around that Jesus in his resurrection body could walk through walls or pass through doors is nonsense. It's a physical body. But he is able to be in different places, move from one place to another instantaneously in this resurrection body. Paul calls it a psychical body. Well, they didn't know that. We know that, but they didn't know that. Peter and John will return to the disciples, and they'll mull over all the possibilities of the empty tomb until tonight. Meanwhile, Mary Magdalene will make her way back to the area of the tomb. She'll keep searching for the body of Jesus. She'll see a stranger in the garden. She'll assume that he's the gardener. Why wouldn't he? It's a garden after all. And she will ask the gardener if he knows anything about the remains of Jesus, only to find that she is seeing and speaking with the risen Lord himself. And she becomes the first person to see him alive after his passion, before, Jesus says, even before he has risen to his Father. No one else sees him in that in-between stage. Now, there is just no getting around this. As Augustine says, we have to reflect on the goodness of the Lord's arrangement that it should be the women who were the first to report that he had risen again. And he goes on to say this, that although a woman was implicated in the fall, Women are implicated in salvation and redemption. Humanity has been restored. A virgin gave birth to the Messiah. A woman proclaimed that he had risen from the dead. And one of the marks of the new covenant, we see it beginning here, one of the marks of the new covenant is that all the old divisions are torn down and we are all one in Christ Jesus. It may very well be that the church's juridical structure is founded on the apostles, and that that's mimicked in the main leader, male leadership of the ordained within the church. But the church's life is populated by both men and women who love the Lord Jesus, who have encounters with the Lord Jesus, who are getting to know Jesus better and to share what they know with others. But we can't leave the tomb empty. We have to ask ourselves, what is the connection between the empty tomb and the cross of Good Friday? You see, the cross and the resurrection, they stand together. Without the resurrection, the cross is a dead end. It also means that you and I are trapped in this tomb. All we have to look forward to is death, and that's it. But the resurrection comes as a great surprise in the Bible. It comes as the best good news there ever was. W.H. Auden, the poet, captures something of this in an expression that he uses in one of his poems. It says this: nothing can save us that is possible. That is, that there is nothing that can keep us from death. There is nothing, no possibility that we can conceive can keep us from dying or can raise us from the dead. There is nothing that is possible that can do that. It is impossible. Nothing that can save us. There is nothing that can save us that is possible. We who must die, that's all of us, we who must die demand a miracle. In this tomb of death, this life in which we are the dying, this land of the dying, nothing is possible. And if we say just that something is possible, George Eliot writes, those are feeble words. But the words of the gospel and the words of Thomas Cranmer, the great reformer, the words of the gospel are comfortable words. Comfortable words. The resurrection proclaims a hope beyond the horizon of what could be, or could be possible, but we know is impossible. We belong to the we who must die. What hope do I have to offer you this morning? Nothing but Easter hope. Nothing can save us that is merely possible. What we need is a stone rolled away. What we need is an empty tomb. What we need is a risen Lord. That risen Lord demonstrates by his rising, by his being raised by the Father, by his being raised by the Holy Spirit, by his raising himself, all of that language is used, that God, the Trinity, has done something that is impossible for us. That God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to the death of the cross, to the burial in the tomb, to the rising from that empty tomb, that he did this so that you and I might have everlasting life. That is the message. That is the only thing that we have to offer you. If you're not a Christian person, that is our message this Easter Sunday. That because all of these circumstances that you find here are almost incredible that they should have happened the way they did, or that men who were full of themselves would allow themselves to be described the way they're described in these chapters. All of that happened because it happened. The grave was empty because the Lord was risen. And when you find the risen Lord, when you confess with your lips Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you too can be saved. Let's pray. Lord, we pray for one another. We pray that we would all be today trusting in this risen Savior. Pray for those who are struggling with Christianity, not believing it, perhaps. I pray that they would revisit the credibility of the story and the wonder that you chose the people who were in that age despised to be the ones to carry the story. We're so grateful we live in a new covenant and a new creation in Christ, and that you, Lord, have poured your Spirit into all of our hearts as your people and given us the hope of glory. That we pray for the one who's struggling today. We pray that you would reveal yourself to her, that you would show yourself to him, that you would bring them to know you as their Savior and as their Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.